Blackstone Publishing presents The Left Behind, Decline and Rage in Rural America by Robert Wuthnow. This book is read by Grover Gardner. Introduction. When the dust settled following the bitterly contentious 2016 presidential campaign, analysts scrambled to make sense of the results. One of the clearest conclusions was that rural communities voted overwhelmingly for the Republican candidate. Hardly anyone credited the rural vote with having decided the election, but the differences between rural and urban or suburban results were striking. Exit polls showed that 62% of the rural vote went to Donald Trump, compared with 50% of the suburban vote and only 35% of the urban vote. Further evidence demonstrated that rural voters had increasingly become Republican in each of the two previous elections. Moreover, the smaller a county's population and the farther it was from a metropolitan area, the more likely it was to have voted for Trump. The leading explanation for the growing rural-urban political divide was that rural people wanted change because they were suffering economically. A related explanation attributed the rural vote to its predominantly white population being racist and misogynist enough, particularly if resentment was involved, to prefer a white male candidate. Both explanations seemed correct on the surface. Rural areas were indeed hurting economically, and they were predominantly white. Grievances about lost jobs and slurs against African Americans, Mexicans, and women surfaced repeatedly at campaign rallies. A Pew poll taken 4 months before the election anticipated that these would be decisive factors. 7 in 10 white rural residents said jobs in their communities were hard to find, and white men seemed particularly bleak about their families' futures and the threats posed by immigrant labor. Figures released by the U.S. Census Bureau also underscored rural hardship. Non-metropolitan incomes in 2015 rose by only 3%, while metropolitan incomes grew by 6%. Pundits suggested that the grievance and resentment arguments probably had merit, yet did not get to the bottom of what might be going on in rural America. Writing in the New York Times a week after the election, Charles M. Blow argued that rural residents were undoubtedly suspicious of big institutions and big government that were located in big cities with big populations of people who don't look like them. In truth, he observed, rural communities were racially and culturally isolated, while cities were cosmopolitan and diverse. In short, the divide was cultural. Kentuckian D. Davis of the Center for Rural Strategies thought, too, that Trump's victory had more to do with culture than policy. "A lot of us in rural areas, our ears are tuned to intonation," he said. "We think people are talking down to us. What ends up happening is that we don't focus on the policy, we focus on the tones, the references, the culture." It certainly seemed plausible that the rural-urban divide was cultural. For more than a century, New York Times editorials had vacillated between romanticized essays about the rustic life and caustic criticisms of backward voters in rural areas who were intent on impeding urban progress. The argument fit Thomas Frank's conclusion in What's the Matter with Kansas, that residents in rural places like Kansas were influenced by conservative ideological beliefs to the point of voting against their own interests. The claim about a cultural divide may have also reminded readers of Barack Obama's ill-advised 2008 remark about small-town voters who get bitter and cling to guns or religion or antipathy to people who aren't like them. But if the divide was cultural, was that all that needed to be said? Was it enough to suggest that rural voters were resentful because they were less cosmopolitan than people living in cities?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.